All right, thank you guys. Can you hear me okay with this lapel mic? All right, we actually have another speaker in the room with us right now, and her name is Nicole Zagman. I want to recognize her right now because Nicole is doing amazing things here in West Michigan, in Grand Rapids in particular. She has a new book coming out, Be Badass and Brilliant, and it's about coaching and mentorship and entrepreneurship for this younger generation here in West Michigan. So if we can just all say thank you to Nicole. Yes. Thank you, Nicole. All right, so my name is Wes O'Donnell, and we are broadcasting on Facebook Live right now to 9 military bases around the country, to an audience somewhere in the neighborhood of 60,000 active duty and veterans. And we want to get this motivational message out to these post-9/11 and these veterans that are active duty right now. And lately, I've been traveling the country on behalf of Military.com and Monster Worldwide, speaking to veterans groups about success. And I also use this travel and this speaking as an opportunity to let veterans and families nationwide know about our town here, Muskegon, and our amazing military museum. And getting this message out will hopefully bring some of them back here. And it occurs to me that I need to give this message of success right here in my hometown. But it's not really my hometown. You see, I recently moved here from Texas. Any Texans? Nobody? There's like a cricket chirping in the background. Tweet, tweet, tweet. Okay, actually the same town that a certain US president is from. You guys know the one. Yeah, that's him. All right, now that I have a whole bunch of Michiganders together in one room, I just need to get a couple things off my chest. Remember, I'm not a stand-up comedian, but seriously, quit putting your hand in my face every time I ask for directions, right? I have a phone, I have an iPhone. All you guys have to do is give me the address. I was gonna ask why your roads are so bad, but I actually figured it out. Last year, I was careening off the road towards a telephone pole, and at the last minute, my tire hit a pothole, saving my life. So your horrible roads are actually a safety feature, and it's clever. It's extremely clever. Number three, when I go to Texas, I have to tell people about this terrifying thing called a Michigan left. As if the snow doesn't make it hard enough for drivers, you guys have to throw in these crazy left-hand turns that nobody really understands. It's called a U-turn, folks. And finally, you think 40 degrees is perfectly acceptable to wear shorts. It is not. All right, all joking aside, I love it here. I like to say that I wasn't born in Michigan, but I got here as fast as I could. And remember, I seemingly have no connection with the city of Muskegon. I moved here so that my wife could be closer to her family. And in an odd twist of fate, I just recently found out that my great-grandfather was the mayor of North Muskegon in the 1920s. Talk about a really strange coincidence. Okay, let's dive in. Anyone can start something, but very few people finish. You, my friends, are finishers. You see, I know something about you, even not knowing you. I know that because of your relationship with the profession of arms, you are much more likely to achieve your wildest dreams of success. The problem is that some of you don't know it yet. Yeah, but Wes, what if my dream is too big? It's not. Impossible is just a big word thrown around by small men. You see, someone watching this right now is going to be the first person to set foot on Mars. Somebody watching this right now is going to be the CEO of their own Fortune 500 company that you create. Somebody watching this right now is going to be president of the United States. There's a new generation of veterans the post-9/11 veteran. They're smart. Smarter than any generation that's come before because they're technologically savvy. In the next two decades, they're going to be responsible for the largest economic boom in U.S. history. I want to change your perception of success. And I want to give you the motivation to make this decade your decade. All right, do me a favor. Turn to the person to your left or right, look them in the eye, shake their hand, and say, "You've got the right stuff." Do that for me now, please. You guys are spaced too far apart. Right stuff. All right, so let's define success. Let me tell you what society says you have to do to be successful. Right? Graduate high school, go to college, or join the military, get a good job, don't get in too much trouble, save for retirement and hopefully some sort of 401k, retire, and then die gracefully. This is what society defines as successful. But life can be so much more broad than that when you realize one simple truth. Everything you see around you, all of this was made up by people who were no smarter than you. Now, success could mean a lot of different things to a lot of different people. But let me tell you my definition of success. Find that thing that truly makes you happy, and then find someone to pay you to do that thing, or do it well enough to pay yourself. I want you to look at your life right now and think about something that's important to you. Something that you'd like to have, or something that you'd like to create for yourself, or for your family, or for society. Maybe there's something in your life that you talked yourself out of, convinced yourself that it wasn't possible. For whatever reason, bring it back out here. How are you going to do it? Don't worry about that right now. You'll become the type of person that can assemble the resources and the people and the money to help make it a reality. The key here is deciding that you're going to do it. What gives your life a sense of fulfillment, a sense of joy? What does a full, rich life mean to you? What is it that you can love doing 7 days a week that'll bring a smile to your face? Now, I got bad news for some of you. If it's Monday and all you can think about is getting to Friday, you're in the wrong job. Time to face yourself. Look yourself in the mirror and ask yourself, what do I want to do? Success doesn't require you to look out the window. It just requires that you look in the mirror. Horace Mann said that we should be ashamed to die until we have made some meaningful contribution to humankind. Leadership starts with you. How can you be expected to lead anybody if you can't take charge of your own destiny? Reminds me of a story of this dog that was lying on a pile of wood. And this dog is moaning and groaning and howling in pain. And this guy walks up. He says, "Hey man, why is this dog moaning and groaning and howling in pain?" And the owner says, "Well, he's sitting on a nail." And the guy goes, "Sitting on a nail? But why doesn't he get off?" And the owner says, "Well, I guess it don't hurt bad enough." Raise your hand if you know somebody that moans and groans about their place in life, but doesn't do anything about it, right? "My job sucks. Man, I hate my boss. My boss is so stupid." This was me, right? I worked at this large German medical company, and I came home and told my wife. I said, "Wife, my boss is so stupid." And she said, "Well, if he's so stupid, why is he the one signing your paycheck?" Yeah, I slept on the couch that night. Most of us go through life pretending that we don't have any goals or ambitions or desires, when really, deep down inside, we do really want more. We block ourselves and we use these words almost like we're in a trance, like we've been sleepwalking through life, that we find ways to cancel out our dreams, that a lot of things we want to do, a lot of places we would like to go, a lot of things we would like to experience, and we just stop at but. But will cause you to hide out behind fear. But will cause you to come up with all types of excuses that you can validate your inaction and not acting on your dream. But is a dream killer. But most people, you know what they do? Most people go through life quietly and safely, tiptoeing to an early grave. We've been holding back. We have ideas that we don't act on. Things we want to do, we're afraid to take chances. See, a lot of people say no to things, and they don't even know what they're saying no to. Don't allow but to keep you in the corner. And there are a lot of people who say, yeah, Wes, but I tried once or twice, and it didn't work out. And so they use that as an excuse not to ever come out again. Look, if things don't work out, if you don't produce the results you want, that's fine, but don't confuse who you are with the results that you produce. You do what you can, where you are, with what you have, and never be satisfied. Don't get satisfied with yourself. Always know that wherever you are, that you can enjoy more, that you deserve more. Why don't you decide now that you're going to expand your world? That if other people can learn, you can learn too. See, if you're working on your dream, sure, there are going to be times when you're going to want to quit. Sure, there are going to be times when life will knock you down and catch you on the blind side. But the challenge is to hold on. And if you hold on tenaciously, I say the universe is on your side. See, if you don't make a decision to live your life, if you don't decide to step into your fears, if you don't decide to say yes to your life, it'll never work for you. You've got to live what's in you. Life is too short and unpredictable. Helen Keller said, life is short and unpredictable. Eat your dessert first. But what do we say? There'll always be tomorrow. Oh, no. No guarantees you're going to show up tomorrow. Always something there to build a case on why you can't move on, why you can't grow to the next level, why you can't begin to manifest your greatness, why you can't begin to live life on your terms, that you're going to say, it's not worth it. Yes, that's going to be right there for you. It's going to be in your face telling you to go back. So if there's something you've always wanted to do, the time for just wishing is past. The time for doing, that's the time right now. And I'm lucky that I had this epiphany in my 30s, right? If my boss is so stupid, why is he the one signing my paycheck? And it hit me, and I had that idea. My boss is running a successful company. I'm smarter than my boss. I could run a more successful company. So this is me. At the time, I had a six-figure salary, Corvette, beautiful house. Do I look happy in that photo? All the material possessions in the world will not make you happy if you're not doing the job that you've been born to do, if you're not becoming the person that you've been born to be. I see this all the time. Stop living your life like you have 1,000 years to live. What's the saying? Here today? Gone today. That's right. A lot of people who were here yesterday aren't here today. A lot of opportunities that were here yesterday aren't here today. So, why do most people wait or not act at all? So I'm working on my next book right now. This is Rise, the Veteran's Field Manual for Starting Your Own Business. I haven't announced it yet for this next book, but I'll give you a sneak peek. Over the past 6 months, I've interviewed right around 100 self-made millionaires to to try and find out what made them successful. And what I discovered was that one word kept coming back to me from these entrepreneurs and from these millionaires. And it's this word, certainty. And it seemed like certainty made the difference between success and failure for these individuals. When someone is absolutely certain about an outcome, when the end result is already a foregone conclusion in your mind, all that's left is the execution. And the people that failed all had one thing in common. They weren't absolutely sure of the end result. They had this wishy-washy, maybe it'll work, maybe it won't, but I'm going to give it the old college try attitude. You have to have certainty that you're on the right path. You have to be able to visualize the outcome. And there's this experiment by a professor at the University of Chicago where he tested some basketball players on their ability to improve their free throw percentage. And he separated people into three groups. And in the first group, he had stand there and shoot free throws for an hour a day. And the second group, he had do nothing but stand there and close their eyes and visualize shooting the perfect free throw. Feel the ball, texture of the ball, the sound, the whoosh when it goes through the net. They didn't actually practice. They just thought about practicing. And the third group, he had do nothing. The results were amazing. The first group, the group that actually practiced, improved their free throw percentage by 30%. The second group, the group that did nothing but visualize the perfect free throw for an hour a day, improved by 29%. Thinking about practicing is almost as good as actually practicing. Imagine combining the two. And in case you're wondering, the third group, as you would expect, had no increase at all. You have to see the end result before it's a reality. You have to believe with absolute certainty that you are something that you're not before you are. And athletes do this all the time, but what about others? I just spoke to a friend of mine who's the DOD counterintelligence specialist for CONUS operations, Continental United States, and he confirmed, sure enough, they mentally run through every hostage rescue over and over and over in their heads. Navy pilots visualize the perfect carrier landing over and over in their heads. And for me personally, to take it to the next level, when I worked on MRI machines, which was my first job when I left the Air Force, when I was working on MRI machines, I used to bring two magazines to work. I used to bring an Auto Trader and an Entrepreneur magazine. And I used to look at these Corvettes, these new Stingrays in this Auto Trader magazine. And I used to say, you know what, I'm going to have that car. What path do I have to take to get there? And I used to visualize the hand-stitched leather, what it felt like, that new car smell. And my colleagues would laugh at me and they'd say, Wes, that's a $90,000 car. There's no way you're going to afford that on our salary. And I said, you're exactly right. That's why the Entrepreneur magazine's there. You're not. All right, that's my baby now. I call it the Queen Anne's Revenge. All right. If you know what you want to do, how do you get started? Maybe your dream is too big. Just do a little bit of it. Devote a little bit of time each day to working on your dream. I like what Robert Schuller says, by the yard is hard, but inch by inch, anything is a cinch. But what I get mostly are people coming to me saying, I don't know what it is that I want to do yet. I know that I'm meant for greatness. What if you don't know what it is you want to do yet? What if you're active duty right now, you just got out of the military, you know you want to do something big, but you don't quite know what that is. Try everything. Try everything. Let me ask you this. How many Mozarts or Beethovens has the world missed out on because somebody never sat down in front of a piano? How many Einsteins has the world lost because somebody never picked up a physics book and instead took over the family business? You don't know what you don't know. There's this minister named Miles Monroe that once said the wealthiest place on earth is not Saudi Arabia where they have oil in the ground. It's not South Africa where they have diamond mines. The wealthiest place on earth is actually the cemetery because there lies all of the big ideas and the dreams and the multi-million dollar ideas that people took with them to their graves. You have talents and skills inside you that you haven't even begun to reach for yet. And most people don't move on their dreams because they don't believe that it's possible for them. They aren't certain of the outcome. Let me show you this. Before 1968, no human had ever run 100 meters in under 10 seconds. They called it the 10-second barrier. It can't be done. Human beings just aren't physically built for that level of speed. It's a physiological limitation of our species, they said. Then, in 1968, a man named Jim Hines comes along and breaks the 10-second barrier. Barely. He did it in 9.95 seconds. Since then, 105 people have broken the 10-second barrier. Why? What changed? We saw Jim Hines break the barrier. And after that, it was no longer impossible. We knew that it could be done. Someone had done it, so in theory, anyone can do it. Sometimes we need to see the person that's doing that thing that we want to do, and that inspires us. All right, you guys awake? Do me a favor. Turn to the person to your left or right, shake their hand, and say, "You've got no limits." Do that for me now, please. That's a chance for me to get a water break. All right, so where do veterans come in? President Barack Obama is the 44th president of the United States. However, there have actually only been 43 men that have held the position, thanks to Grover Cleveland serving two non-consecutive terms. So, out of 43 presidents, how many were veterans? Raise your hand, because the right answer gets General Patton the Bear here. Out of 43 men, how many were veterans? The closest answer, I should say.
39.
What? You said 16? Teresa, you're disqualified. You work here. Getting close. 16 is the closest. Oh, all right. Yes. 23 is getting extremely close. 26. Let's in the interest of time, let's say 26. The majority of U.S. presidents have been military veterans. In fact, I would even go so far as to say that if you're a veteran, you have a better chance of being elected our commander-in-chief, although since the past election, I have no idea anymore. Some of our best presidents have been veterans. Ronald Reagan, John F. Kennedy, Theo Roosevelt, Abraham Lincoln, and of course, our very first president, George Washington. Okay, for a Silversides hat, what branch of service was Ronald Reagan in? Yeah, hold on a second. No, no. What was your? No, Army Air Corps. Yes, sort of a trick question too. He was in the Army Reserves before World War II. During World War II, he was in the Army Air Corps stateside. All right. One more. How many veterans right now are in Congress for a Silversides canteen? 44? Closer. Closer. How many veterans are in Congress? Remember, Congress is a big place. I think Don here got the closest. Let's say less than 20%, 81. 81. I don't know if we should be giving those to board members. Are you qualified? All right. 81. Very interesting. Around the year 1975, 70% of Congress was made up of veterans. Today, that number is less than 20%. We're definitely not well represented. And we need people with military experience leading this country. My mission in life is to get more veterans into business and politics. And that's what's great about the USS Silversides, is that we honor veterans every single day. Success-minded veterans are also largely responsible for the massive economic boom of the 1950s. In 1944, the GI Bill helped veterans returning home from World War II earn college degrees, train for vocations, support young families, buy farms. My own grandfather, who was an ace fighter pilot for the Marine Corps in the Pacific, came home and opened a dry cleaners in Dallas, Texas, using the GI Bill. The most important part was that veterans were and are 50% more active in their communities and civic associations. And in the 50s and 60s, many veterans joined the civil rights movement to expand equal rights for future generations. If we're not all equal, they thought, then what the hell are we fighting for? So why? What qualities do veterans possess exclusively as a byproduct of their military training that makes them more likely to achieve success? And if you're not a veteran, what skills can you borrow or emulate from veterans to make you more likely to achieve success? Number one, leadership at every level. At age 19, I was put in charge of $6 million of government equipment, and I had colleagues who, in their 20s, were appointed interim governors of entire towns in the Middle East. There is no better anvil on the planet to forge a 21st century leader than the U.S. military. Building world-class leaders is what we do. It's in our DNA. It's who we are in the profession of arms. Are there good leaders outside of the U.S. military? Of course there are. But I would argue that they're fewer and farther between. Composure and creativity under extreme pressure. You guys may have seen this recently. The Air Force Times just released an article about an F-16 fighter jet that had a malfunction. It could only sustain 500 pounds of fuel at a time. He was going to have to eject over ISIS-controlled territory. Now, in my mind, there are very few things that an Air Force fighter pilot fears. One of those things is ejecting over ISIS-controlled territory. So what happened? This KC-135, which is essentially a flying gas can, stepped up to the plate and refueled the Falcon every 15 minutes all the way back to base. And if you know anything about aerial refueling, it's an extremely dangerous procedure, even by trained professionals. This is the very definition of composure and creativity under extreme pressure. And our veterans are bringing this with them out into the civilian world. And they're attacking problems, both as entrepreneurs, in business, and in society in general. Integrity first. This is actually one of the Air Force's core values. Integrity is one of those things that the military takes pride in its service members, beating it into them and making sure that they're truthful, honest, and have integrity. So I worked at this large medical company, and we had this big machine called an intraoperative MRI machine. Normally, when you're removing a brain tumor from a child, what'll happen is you're in the operating room, and the doctor will remove the tumor, sew up the child, wheel the child out into the hallway, into an elevator, into the basement, where the child gets an MRI done. So this company's big idea was to make an MRI machine that came in on rails from the ceiling all the way into the operating room. So the doctors would collect their surgical instruments, they'd leave the room, the MRI machine would come in while the child was still cut open, they'd get an image, and the MRI machine would leave the room safely. And then they could see instantaneously whether they were able to remove all the tumor. And this interventional MRI machine was able to save a number of children's lives. My team discovered a fault in something called a head fixation device. And it's a device that screws into the child's skull to keep the child's head completely motionless during this procedure. And I took it to my CEO, David, I'm not going to say his last name, I took it to my CEO, and he said, you know what, Wes, it's going to cost millions of dollars to recall these HFDs, these head fixation devices. And it's a very low likelihood of it failing, so we're not going to tell the FDA about it, which is the federal agency that manages medical devices, and you're going to be quiet about it. I quit. That was the point at which I quit the company and started my own business, MD Advantages in Dallas, Texas. That level of integrity that veterans have, you have to have that level of integrity in everyday interactions. And what you'll find is that in society, veterans bring this with them into business, and they operate at a higher level. They understand loyalty, they understand integrity, and you can trust them to do the right thing, even when no one is looking. Now, obviously, any group is going to have individuals that don't reflect the best qualities of the entire group, but by and large, I would say veterans operate on a higher level of integrity. By the way, that company is now out of business. They are bankrupt. And no children were ever hurt. Habitual goal orientation. Yes, any so-called success guru will talk to you about the importance of setting goals. A goal must require you to take action, not reaction. And massive action get massive results. Military members equate competence, task orientation, and positive attitudes as essential to mission accomplishment. They leave the military and they bring this mindset with them into the civilian world. And another thing they bring is something called the AAR, or After Action Report. That's what we called it in the Army. In the Air Force, we called it the debrief. And you'll see a lot of corporations now, a lot of forward-thinking corporations are adopting this, but it's essentially, we look at the last mission, we look at what went wrong, what went right, and we go into this cycle of after-action review. We constantly improve our process so that what results is flawless execution. You get to a point where an F-15 fighter pilot goes on a bombing mission, and it's this flawless execution because they've corrected their mistakes slowly over time, mission after mission. You bring this with them, this debrief, this after-action review, and it's amazing for businesses. All right, diversity and inclusion in action. In 1965, a black U.S. Army soldier named Milton Olive III was on patrol with his squad in Vietnam. You guys may have heard of this. There's an actual park in Chicago, Milton Olive Park. They made contact with the enemy. Viet Cong quickly retreated, and Olive's squad gave chase. One of the Viet Cong turned around and lobbed a grenade back towards Olive's squad. And PFC Olive nonchalantly said, "I got it," and lay down on it. PFC Olive was posthumously awarded the Medal of Honor. And in jumping on that grenade, he saved the lives of his squad, both black men and white men. And in doing so, taught us all how we ought to live. You see, service members don't care about race, religion, or gender. That was never something that came up, at least in my experience in the military. So from 1997 to 2007, the time that I was in the military, I didn't experience it, I didn't witness it being experienced. I come out of the military in 2007 thinking racism is dead. That's something from the 60s and 70s. That doesn't exist anymore. Make absolutely no mistake, America is powerful because of its diversity. Different people bring a wealth of different experiences that help us adapt in a world where the challenges are changing faster than many people can respond to. Challenges that are sometimes overwhelming. And soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines know better than anyone that mission accomplishment doesn't care about race, religion, or gender. So what are we seeing today? What does the civilian landscape look like now that we're seeing this massive influx of post-9/11 veteran entering the civilian world? So I'll touch on me personally before I go into a couple of other examples. When I was in and out of these hospitals working for this medical company, I noticed there was a problem. And I came up with a solution to that problem. And it's sort of a ridiculous problem when you think about it, but there's medical carts all over every hospital. And what I noticed was that doctors and nurses always had a crash cart around, but they never had an anesthesia cart. Or they had an anesthesia cart, but they never had a pediatric cart. And so my idea was to make a modular medical cart. And that was where the drawer module was interchangeable, and you could make the cart whatever you wanted. So this took me 5 minutes in Microsoft Paint. Several years ago, I was able to link up with a gifted CAD designer that spit out this. And this was the OmniCart version 1. Horrible name, I know. And when you pull up these gray handles on the sides, the drawer module slides out on wheels of its own and can be quickly swapped out for anything else. And I had these visions of getting them into VA hospitals and military hospitals all over the country. And you know what? Let's take it one step further. Let's get out of healthcare and let's take it to NASCAR and people that use different tool sets that need to swap them out quickly. Aircraft maintenance. And before I could even get this little company off the ground and go seeking a manufacturer, I did get one built. I did get a prototype built. Before I could even get that far, this much larger company came in and offered to buy my patent. They offered me X amount of dollars and royalties on every one they sold for the next 20 years. And then I had to have a serious conversation with myself. And I said, do I really want to be in the medical cart business? No, I don't. I don't. So I cashed out. I took the money and ran and closed the company. And haven't looked back since. And I got seduced by e-commerce. And I opened a company called Modern Workspace, which sold high-tech office furniture. I built it up to a point where it was profitable, and somebody offered to buy it. So I cashed out, and I sold it. You see a pattern here. I'm like a serial entrepreneur. I love starting businesses. I love the energy of the chaos here, which is what's great about working here. Just kidding, Mark. And finally, I settled into Warrior Lodge, which is an incredible website that actually generates money from advertisements that are built into the site. I don't have any experience in building websites. I got onto YouTube and watched a tutorial and put ads on it. Warrior Lodge is now generating $1,000 a day in advertising revenue. And I'm the only employee. And having a veteran, I'm not telling you this to impress you, I'm telling you this to impress upon you what veterans are doing right now, what active duty can do when they get out. Heck, what active duty can do while they're still in. And of course, Warrior Lodge wouldn't be successful without Facebook. Facebook, the ability to build an audience, send them over to your website where you can make money on them. And what's funny is that these memes like this are actually what make money. Marines after the ASVAB, so that's an Air Force guy carrying a Marine because Marines aren't very smart. That's the idea. And then it's okay, Airmen. It's supposed to make that loud bang sound. That's a Marine carrying an Airman because he had to shoot a gun. And Air Force people don't shoot guns. And U.S. Coast Guard playing pretend Navy since 1915. That one's just for you, Tom. Right. Veterans in film and television. You'll see a lot of veterans doing this right now. They're getting out of the military and they're heading to Hollywood, a lot of the post-9/11 veterans. I created a profile just to see what the inside of this was like. You have to prove that you served in the military to be able to get into this site. And then you have Hollywood agents looking at this and requesting your skills. Adam Driver, I think his name is, Iraq veteran, modern veteran, starred in the new Star Wars movie. And so you see the success of these younger veterans getting gigs like this in Hollywood. Grunt Style, a t-shirt company started by a former Army drill sergeant, now a multi-million dollar a year t-shirt business exclusively online. It's crazy what the resourcefulness of these younger veterans are that they're bringing with them when they leave. Matt Best, YouTube celebrity, somebody who's also a millionaire from acting stupid on the internet. It's out there. The money's out there. These veterans are resourceful enough to identify it and go after it. And they have the skills that's making them rich. And this is the same guy, Matt Best, doing pull-ups on a helicopter. So what you're seeing from these successful veterans is that it's possible. Success is calling you. The profession of arms built you for success. So you already have this massive head start because of the type of person that the American military makes you into. But what are some practical lessons that can guarantee your success, or at least help you along that path? So we talked about this, but find that thing in your life that would give you a full, rich life. What is it? Maybe own a bed and breakfast? Astronaut? Take that limiter off your brain and operate on the assumption that literally anything is possible. Don't sabotage yourself before you even begin. Now listen up, because this part's important. Choose your group of friends very carefully. Outside of the military, where people's pay isn't strictly defined by pay grade, what you'll find is that your salary is the average of your five closest friends. When I found that out, I started to make some friends with some rich people right away. And you're going to have those people in your life who are doubters. Wait, Wes, you're going to start your own business? That's not you, man. You're going to get up in front of people and speak? They laughed at me. They're going to laugh at you too. In fact, the bigger your dream, the harder they're going to laugh. Why? Because your success reminds them of a time when they tried and failed and didn't get back up and revisit it again. Even your friends and family will be envious of your ambition. And you need to be careful because you have some self-doubt already in your brain. And the dangerous part is if you have these negative people around you telling you why something can't be done, it might confirm your own little bit of self-doubt. And then you're going to talk yourself out of it, and you're going to convince yourself that your idea is stupid. And then 10 years down the road, you're going to see someone else making $1 million off of your idea. And you're going to kick yourself, and you're going to say, see, I knew that was a good idea. And one more thing about people, if you're the smartest person in your group, you need to find a new group. When I started MD Advantages, I called a meeting of my department heads when we were still young, and I said, the day that I walk in here and I know more than you guys, you're all fired. And I guarantee they stayed ahead of me past that point. You need to surround yourself with people that force you to stretch your mind, that challenge you, that force you to constantly stretch yourself. The problem is that we have a lot of people today, a lot of the younger generation, and veterans included, that are comfortable with average. Nobody really likes average, right? Your boss doesn't like average. Your professor doesn't like average. Nobody really likes average. So the next time you give a low effort, the next time you give a 70% effort or a 50% effort, I want you to go back and think about what you were thinking about at the time you gave that low effort. And I'd be willing to bet you were thinking about the obligation and not the opportunity. You were thinking, I got to versus I get to. And I hear this, yeah, Wes, how can I find opportunity in homework? You have to become that person that sees opportunity in everything. Opportunity isn't something that comes along once in your life, and you're lucky if you grab it. You can become the type of person that creates opportunity. Yeah, that sounds all well and good. That sounds fluffy, Hallmark card. You create your own opportunity. But it works. There's stuff that you can do. I wanted to give a TED Talk. TED, if you don't know what it is, it's ideas that can change the world, and they give you 15 minutes to stand up and say something meaningful. And so I had this idea that I wanted to give a TED talk. And I knew the TED people were going to be in town here in Muskegon speaking at a Rotary Club meeting. I snuck into the Rotary Club meeting, and I wrote down my name on the little sticker. I stuck it right here on my chest, and I sat down and made small talk. And I didn't eat because I didn't pay for it. And at the end of the TED presentation, I went up to the people and I said, hey, I want to speak. I want to do a TED talk. And they said, well, sure, we'd love to have you. Come on down and give us your pitch. And I had to go in, compete against other people, and give my pitch and earn my spot giving a TED speech. But I would have never gotten that. I didn't really sneak in. Frank let me in. And I wouldn't have gotten that if you don't see that opportunity and seize it and create that opportunity for yourself. And there's another lesson that I like to pass on, and it's about mentorship. And I used to see my life like this massive maze, right? We're all born into this maze of life, and you have these dead ends, and you have these pitfalls, and you have a couple of different paths that are going to get you out. And the beauty is, if you have that mentor that can come back, who's doing that thing that you want to do, who can come back and say, you know what, don't go that way. That way right there is a dead end. That way there is a dead end. Follow me and I'll show you how to get to the place you're trying to go. I wanted to design and patent a modular medical cart. How do you do that? I wanted to sell them to VA and military hospitals. How the hell do you do that? Who's done that before? You have to identify that person and ask. And it might be intimidating to you, but if you don't ask, the answer is always no. Or as my mom used to say, closed mouth never gets fed. I cannot stress the importance of a mentor. A mentor will give you that crucial confidence to aim high and bury that self-doubt. And my message to active duty especially is that when you're working on your goals, I want you to aim high. The old Air Force motto, I want you to aim high. Most people fail at life, not because they aim too high and miss, but because they aim too low and hit. Or as Les Brown says, shoot for the moon. You might miss, but at least you'll end up among the stars. So I made a promise to myself 20 years ago, and I never shared this with anyone. You guys are going to be the first. That, and I told my wife this, that I'm going to run for president in 2032. I told her this 20 years ago, and she didn't laugh at me. She looked at me with a straight face. And she said, okay, I believe you. That's the aim high goal. Run for president in 2032, right? By the way, Wes is more in 2032. So what happens if I never reach that goal? What happens? Nothing. Imagine what I will have accomplished along the way. Just imagine. Military veteran, small business owner, working in public service, Congress, running for Congress in the state of Michigan. And we'll see. And we'll see. Even if I don't make it, imagine what you will have accomplished. That's the value of aiming high. All right. And the most important key for all of veteran success is that really you have to want it. You have to want it, and you have to want it bad. And there was this story of this self-help guru that came to talk to a bunch of Marines down in Coronado. And this kid comes up afterwards, and he says, hey, I want you to tell me the real secret of success. And the guru says, you want to know the real secret of success? Meet me down at the ocean at 3 a.m. tomorrow morning. And he's like, 3 a.m.? Okay, what should I wear? And he's like, just wear your best suit. So the guy shows up at 3 a.m. the next morning, and sure enough, the guru is there waiting for him. And he says, okay, you want to know the real secret to success? Follow me out into the water. And the guy's confused, but he follows him, and they get out to where they're about knee-high, and they keep walking out in the water, and they get out to about waist-high. And the guy stops and says, I don't understand what this has to do with success. You're supposed to tell me the secret to being successful. And he says, no, keep coming. So they keep walking out until they're about neck deep in the water. And all of a sudden, the guru grabs the marine and plunges him underwater. And he's holding him there. And a minute goes by. And the marine starts to struggle a little bit. 2 minutes go by. And the marine is really clawing, trying to get his way back up above the water. And after 3 minutes, the guru grabs the marine, pulls him up out of the water, and says, quick, what were you thinking about just now? What did you want more than anything else? And he says, breathe. I just wanted to breathe. And he says, when you want to succeed, as bad as you want to breathe, then you will be successful. You got to want it that bad. And that was the lesson for that young Marine, is that you got to want it more than life itself. It's hard. Championships aren't won in the theater of the arena. Success is born in the 5 a.m. runs and at 2 a.m. studying in the library. You have to study as long as it takes. You have to do as many push-ups as it takes. And most people won't make those sacrifices now to get that reward later. They won't do it. Most people are soft. It's a soft generation. They aren't willing to give away that comfort now for more comfort later. You have to be willing to live like most people won't so that you can someday live like most people can't. So when we talk about, let's talk about failure real quick. I don't want to dwell on it. And I'm all about shifting the spotlight off a lot of the negativity you hear about the post 9/11 veterans. 22 vets a day commit suicide, the veteran unemployment rate, etc. And I want to shift the spotlight on the good things. But when we talk about failure, especially in the profession of arms, we talk about failure is not an option, right? Failure in our job as military members might mean mission failure. And that's the loss of life for us, for our teammates, our allies, possibly civilians. And society reflects this. We hate it when our sports team loses. If we fail a class, we have to repeat it. In my world, in my previous life, in the world of entrepreneurship, this thinking is so dangerous. It's because of this allergy to failure that people that decide that to actually follow their dreams and their big ideas give up the first time they fail. They say, oh, it wasn't meant to be. Veterans and active duty who are going into entrepreneurship and going into business need to get semi-comfortable with the idea that all roads to success, you have to go through failure and pain to get there. And just because you fail doesn't make you a failure. A lot of people think that failure is a step backwards. No. Failure is a step forward, step in the right direction. Every time you fail, you learn something from it. You gain something from it. You feel less anxiety about that thing when you're doing it again. You're going to tell me that's a step backwards? Nobody ever tells you this. Nobody ever tells you this, but you're supposed to fail. You're supposed to fail. It's built into the system. As the saying goes, if it was easy, everybody would do it. It's supposed to be hard. When we're talking about success, it's not going to happen overnight. It's not going to happen overnight. It's not going to happen as quickly as you want it to happen. There's this old tale about the Chinese bamboo tree. It's a tree that takes 5 years to grow. And when people go through the process of growing this tree, the tree doesn't break through the ground until the fifth year. And then in 5 weeks, it skyrockets up to 90 feet tall. So the question is, does it grow 90 feet tall in 5 weeks or 5 years? The answer is 5 years, because at any point, had they stopped watering and fertilizing that tree, it would have failed. And what you'll have is that when you're working on your big idea, when you're working on that big idea, you get out of the military, you want to start your own business, you start working on that big idea, working on your dream, you're going to be putting in work every single day. and you might not see the results for years. And you're going to have people coming up to you saying, really? You're still working on that big idea? Maybe it's time to do something else. And guess what? If you listen to them and you quit, maybe it was the next day that your big idea would have shot up 90 feet. Success is supposed to be brutal. It's supposed to be hard. That's what separates us from the other 97% of the population. The population that's comfortable with average. Now, you're going to have some ups and you're going to have some downs. Anybody can feel good when they have their health, their bills are paid, they're in happy relationships. Anybody can be positive then. Anybody can have faith under those types of circumstances. The real challenge of growth, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually, comes when you get knocked down. It takes courage to act. After life has punched you in the face, it takes courage to get back up again. You want it, and you're going to go all out to have it. It's not going to be easy when you want to change. If it were easy, everybody would do it. But if you're serious, you'll go all out. You have got to make a declaration that this is what you stand for. You're standing up for your dreams. You're standing up for peace of mind. You're standing up for your health. Take full responsibility for your life. Accept who you are and the responsibility that you're going to take yourself where you want to go. Live your life with passion, with some drive. Decide that you're going to push yourself. The last chapter to your life has not been written yet, and it doesn't matter about what happened to you yesterday. What matters is, what are you going to do today? Today, I'm going to make this decade my decade. I'm not going to talk about it anymore. The time for just talking is past. Time for doing, that's the time right now. Time to live the values from the profession of arms. Take those values with you into the civilian world and leave your mark on the world. Thank you, guys. That's my time. Ooh.